Hey, what's going on, fam? We got a different type of moto vlog today. We got the wife in here. Wife, come on over here. Come on over here. Say hello to the people. We're going to do a dual moto vlog. Say what's up. Can I hear you, mic check?
What's up?
Hey.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh. Yeah, wife, come on. Get up on chill. Yeah. All right. So we wanted to do a different type of moto vlog today. I wanted to let y'all hear from the wife in case y'all have any women in your lives who don't want to let you really ride your motorcycle. What was you thinking when I first wanted to get a motorcycle? Were you hesitant? Were you like, I don't really want him to? What were your thoughts when I first brought up the idea of getting one?
Well, yeah, I didn't really want you to. You know, the stigma behind motorcycles was just danger, and so it was like, well, if I let him ride, is he gonna come back to me?
Did anybody in your family have motorcycles? Like, how did you? What was your experience with them growing up?
I have a very motorcycle-friendly family. My dad didn't get one until later, but he used to have one back in the day. But I wasn't super comfortable around them because I didn't have one in the household, but I knew about them because they were around.
So what did I do to help ease your concerns about me riding?
Statistics. You pulled about all the stats you can on why accidents happen and whose fault it is and how you can prevent them. So it made me feel more comfortable seeing that most accidents were rider related, being careless. And so it came down to just being able to trust you to be careful.
So also with me getting a sport bike, did you ever think that sports bikes were more dangerous? Because that's one of the stigmas too, that you know, crotch rockets are what's dangerous. And that kind of takes away from the fact that it's people riding these things that are more dangerous than the bike. So I know I kind of went on there, but with the idea of me getting a sport bike, did that make you any more uncomfortable than if I was in the market for, say, a cruiser?
Well, a little bit, because they do call them crotch rockets. So it was like, and then going down the highway, you'll see a bunch of mainly sports bikes going or doing crazy stuff and doing wheelies. And so it was like, well, are you going to conform and fit into that, or are you just going to do your own thing and enjoy the bike?
Okay. All right, fellas, so you heard it from the wife. You got to pull up some stats and everything. So did that truly help, or was it more so me just, you know, staying on the topic and where you just like, well, he's going to do it anyway? Or did it actually help me pulling up and showing you these statistics?
Well, I knew you were going to do it anyway, so there was no way I could just be like, you're not going to ride a motorcycle. I mean, I can't take that away from you. You enjoy it. So it was you pulling up the stats, and it was like, okay, well, this is why it happens. Now I just have to trust that he's actually going to be careful. So I didn't actually feel comfortable until you were riding for at least 6 months, and it was like, and I had ridden behind you to see how, well, not to see, but in instances I had to ride behind you first for a reason or not, and I could see how careful you were, so then I felt more comfortable. But taking the bike to the track was a whole nother conversation.
Oh yeah, for sure. So talking about that, when you're saying you were riding behind me, she means driving, right? That's what she's talking about. When
yes,
you were in
I'm
your
sorry.
Car
driving
following
behind
me
you.
Somewhere. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So fellas, if you want to get your wife on the same page, you gotta convince her. Well, not convince her, because convince sounds like you're trying to, you know, kind of coerce or manipulate. But you have to prove that a lot of motorcycle accidents are or can be prevented by the rider. The rider is 9 times out of 10 the main contributing factor. And then you have to prove to her that you will be responsible.
Exactly.
And also it helps if you got a great wife like I got. You know what I'm saying? My wife is great. You know, you heard her say she wasn't going to tell me you can't do nothing. So, and I said this in another video, you know, it's that could put a lot of stress on a relationship once y'all start putting absolutes on things. Like, you can't do this. You know, nobody wants to feel like they can't do what they want to do. But at the same time, you know, I respect my wife enough to, if she was to where she was concerned, that I wanted to ease her concern. So it wasn't like I was just like, nah, I'm the man. What I say goes. I don't feel like that really works. So I wanted to make sure she was comfortable. And I wanted to make sure I did everything in my power to keep her comfortable.
And then he crashed.
Hey, we gonna get to that too. So I imagine a vlog like this will bring new viewers to the channel. So if y'all don't know, I started my motorcycle riding journey on a sport bike. My first street bike is a CBR 600RR. And through my journey, you know, I transitioned from just being a street rider to only riding my bike on track to not even wanting to ride sport bikes on street anymore, to where now I got Loretta Hill, my street sweeper, and this is the only thing I ride on street. So I have had 3 crashes. 1 major one, really. And my major one was actually on the street. So this crash happened after I started going to the track. And then I went to somewhere where I was really familiar and I was pushing the bike too hard. Ended up low siding at 70 miles an hour. Crashed off into a little ditch. Luckily, I didn't get injured. You know, I just had some micro fracturing in a couple of my fingers. But other than that, I was uninjured. I had all my gear on, even had an airbag vest on, and I believe that airbag vest saved some ribs. But, why, if you want to talk to him about that experience, the phone call you got, how you felt, all of that.
That was stressful. He called me, and he was the first thing out of his mouth was, "I'm okay, but the motorcycle's not." He said, "I can't drive it home. We got to either trailer it somehow." I had to figure out somehow to take it home. And so he didn't send me any pictures, so I'm thinking, I talked to him, he's fine. He probably crashed, it's not that bad, but I gotta go get something. But knowing that it couldn't be driven back home, I was like, well, it's in some type of bad shape. Well, when I got to this, to the accident, I guess you could say, the bike was in shambles. So I was stressed the whole way, but I threw everything in the car, went and rented a Home Depot transit van, and threw all the tools in the back, and then took off. That bike was not okay. It was just like, how are you okay?
Right.
But it was fine, and we loaded up the bike and got it home, because, you know, those vans are pretty expensive, so we had 75 minutes to get it back. But I think I was a little more apprehensive after that. I do know he was pushing, and it was a little bit, there was a little bit of pride involved, I believe. But he was okay.
I kind of went back on what I said, huh? Like, I ain't going to be doing nothing reckless on the street.
Yes. and then it was a little reckless. But I think at that point you had been riding on the track for a while, so it wasn't like I felt like, okay, he needs to stop riding. It was just, okay, now he needs to be more careful.
Yeah, so this happened after we started track riding. I think I probably had 2 track days in, maybe 3. I think I had done 3 track days before my street accident.
Even 4.
I think it was 3, because it was the first year, and we only got 3 track days in that first year. Even then, I had already started slowing up my street riding. I was definitely putting in less miles. I was spending less time on the street, because on that track, it's just crazy seeing what the bike can do, and then you go to the street and it's not as much fun, because you can't do what you did on the track on the street. At least that's how I was feeling about it. So what was more stressful, my first crash or our first track day?
Oh, definitely the first track day.
Ooh. So unfortunately, at the first track day, you know, it took her some convincing. I think it was harder to get her on board with track riding than it was me getting a motorcycle in the first place. What do you think? Is that accurate?
That is very accurate.
So the track was a more stressful, it was more stressful to her, the idea of it.
Yeah, I really knew nothing of it. And you think track and you just think fast and you think curves. And it's like, well, how's this going to work?
Ooh, that was a terrible downshift. Right. So not only that, so she has all these stresses for the first track day. The first track day we go to, everything starts off fine. The day is going well. I've been in no sticky situations. And then the last session of the day, before I get to go out again, track goes silent. And once you start track riding, you know, when the track goes silent, usually not a good sign. Sometimes it's fine, you know, sometimes you just got to clear something off the track, and that's what you hope for. But the track stayed silent for so long, and unfortunately somebody lost their life on the track. So I know that was stressful for you, wife.
I started out nervous. I was feeling better throughout the day. I was like, okay, I can do this. It's fun. He can enjoy it. It's a controlled environment. And then that happened. And then, of course, not knowing why it happened, because you're thinking, okay, it's something track related, only track related. And it was hard. I mean, it was a very quiet ride home. It was about a 2-hour drive home, and I couldn't really put my feelings into words. I was just scared, yeah. Emotional a little bit.
After somebody died on the track, you know, I was a little shook too. I was like, man, this is supposed to be safer. And I don't know if anybody who has passed away on the street, not personally, I've never met anybody or have been that close to an accident where somebody lost their life. So yeah, the track thing did shake me up for about the whole ride home. Then after that, I was like, man, you know what? It is what it is. We're gonna have to keep it going. But yeah, that was definitely stressful too. I think we went off long enough. Let me know if y'all want to do another interview with the wife, because we've had some experiences. And if y'all want to hear any more about them, let me know, because we've been going off about 14 minutes already. It's going to be a long video, but that's all right. Y'all stay blessed. Don't be too stressed. Master Yoshi and Mrs. Yoshi out. Peace.